Hello, everybody. So today, I want to talk to you about responsible tech. But I want to start by talking about issues like tech utopianism. There are many, many people at this conference who truly believe that technology is the end of all of our problems. We can solve anything with technology, that technology will result in a world where benefits accrue to everyone equally, that we can solve world hunger, pandemics. And that's just not the case. That doesn't say technology doesn't have a role to play or that it doesn't have impacts. But on the other hand, we don't want people thinking about tech dystopianism. We don't want people thinking about how everything is wrong. We don't have Luddites. We shouldn't have Luddites. Technology does have a role to play, even though technology has resulted in all kinds of things. Pollution, it's worsening inequality, environmental collapse. You just have to look at the pictures of the ocean with the big plastic bubble. Just think of all the wonderful things plastic has given us, including this big plastic bubble in the ocean filled with trash. And in fact, even something as well thought out as Asimov's robotic laws, when we start to think about what technology might look like, law number three is kind of the escape clause. And if we truly believe that we're going to be building intelligent systems, why do we think we're not eventually going to build a system that is more intelligent than we are? At some point, that is going to happen. However, there's a middle ground for which I'm very grateful. I consider myself a pragmatist. I believe strongly that advances in technology often have the potential for good, most often are okay, we've got to mitigate the risks, and occasionally things go horribly wrong. And we need to be aware of that. But technology can do all of these things. The good. We've got remediation strategies for the environment that are a result of technology, where we can actually clean up some of the messes that we created in the past. Food production has increased. We've had an impact on education and medicine. Just think how quickly we got a vaccine. That's technology. That's things that have been worked on for years that have resulted in something that has made a crucial difference in fighting this pandemic. The okay list was probably the harder one to come up with, because some people would say weapons always bad. Some people would say at least we're making more humane weapons. Entertainment apps. Some of them can be very educational. They can help bring people out of their shell. We have technology that will allow for interactions to take place in ways that we haven't been able to before. Many people talk about the value, for example, of autonomous trucks. Wouldn't it be so much better to not have to worry about a truck driver falling asleep? Because they work long hours, trucks are big, physics matters, and so the world would be a much safer place if we eventually get to the point where we have autonomous trucks. But what about the truck stops? Not only just the truck drivers, but the entire economy that supports the people driving day after day, mile or kilometer after mile or kilometer. How do we handle that? And then, of course, I put AI in the possible category as well. I'm not of the school that is worried that the robot apocalypse will come in my lifetime. But I do worry about some of the consequences. When recommendation engines just determined what kind of mailers I got, yes, I'm that old that I used to get that kind of stuff, or what Amazon shows me, if I don't like it, that's not catastrophic. But what about a medical recommendation? We're using AI in ways that have enormous impact on our lives. But then there's also the ugly. Weapons of mass destruction, pollution, inequality, social, economic inequality, disease. Okay, why is disease coming from technology? Well, actually, as we build out our society and start to destroy habitats, that's where these things come from. But a big issue for us as technologists is that we are actually very bad at predicting unintended consequences. Think about it. What are we first and foremost as technologists? We're problem solvers. We are the people who look at a problem, look at a target audience that is suffering from this problem, and we're saying, what can I do to solve that problem? And we are laser focused on that problem. And it's very difficult to see, oh, well, what about the people over here? How might they be impacted by me solving this problem for these people? Or what might the other impacts be? So we have to, as technologists, acknowledge that we can't do this by ourselves because we're too good at our job. We're too good at solving the problem. We need perspectives. We need to get outside our own head to figure out how things could go wrong. And so what kinds of things could go wrong? This is a small sampling, but hopefully you'll recognize at least some of them. Bias. Now, very often when people hear bias, the hairs on the back of the neck stand up. Are you telling me I'm biased? Are you telling me I'm a bad person? No. One of my favorite examples that really seems to take some of the negative energy out of a discussion of bias. There was a teaching hospital that I read about, and they were trying to train a model to determine whether or not a patient, after a particular procedure, should be put directly into the intensive care unit or not. And they trained it using two different techniques. One model worked extremely well, but it was very difficult. You couldn't discern any of the decision-making criteria. And then the second one didn't do quite as well, but it was very clear. And they started looking through this, and they found that any asthmatic patient would probably die, because their protocol had always been to immediately put all asthmatics into the intensive care unit. Their data set, therefore, did not include anything at all about asthma. And if you think about how models work, if there was nothing in there about asthma, if nobody had asthma, it wouldn't know anything to say about asthma. No one would say those researchers were prejudiced, were maliciously attempting to kill asthmatics. But that's bias. There was a bias in that data set that they didn't know about. Unintentionally biased algorithms. One of the things, and I don't hear this so much anymore, so I'm a bit more optimistic, people will say, well, of course, my Facebook feed is completely objective. It's run by an algorithm. And it's like, what do you think an algorithm is? There is a goal. There is something that says, what order am I putting these things in? That's the algorithm's job. And whoever is determining the order and what goes in and what doesn't go in, that person has some decision-making criteria. That is an objective. That objective might not be aligned to what is in your best interest. It's probably not. Unintentionally biased outcomes result from unintentionally biased data sets and unintentionally biased algorithms. Bias isn't just I am maliciously prejudiced against something. Bias is you have to look at the system that results in your data set, just like the hospital had unintentionally biased that data set. Ethics. Autonomous vehicles. This is one of the more common ones that you'll hear about. Who should be deciding whether the driver lives or a pedestrian lives if the car can't save both? Unfortunately, car manufacturers did an interesting survey a few years ago. They asked two questions. The first was, what do you think we should program the car to do? And everybody very altruistically said, protect the pedestrian. Second question, which car would you buy? Protect the driver. Okay, what are you supposed to do? Do we actually want some corporation deciding for us what is the ethical thing to do? What about robots? We think, oh, if I had a mind-sniffing robot, wouldn't that be wonderful? I don't even have to risk the life of a dog, a mind-sniffing dog to go in. We can just blow up the machine, which is fine. But when does this robot get intelligent enough that we have to start thinking about its rights? If we make an intelligent domestic assistant, even if we program it to say, yes, I adore scrubbing toilets and ironing shirts. This is my goal in life, is to clean toilets and iron shirts. Is that right? Isn't, you know, how do we think about these things? And finally, abuse. I heard an interesting discussion recently, which basically came down to the rather obvious fact, what you don't have, you don't have to protect. The more data we collect, and everybody seems to think more data, the more data we collect, the bigger the honeypot is for the people who are going after the data. And think about the asymmetry here. Any individual organization has to defend itself against the entire army of hackers with all of their different strategies. The hacker can identify one target and throw all of their resources at that one. That's an incredible power asymmetry. Manipulation. I was in another discussion here at this event with someone who was talking about how much it freaked him out when he went to a particular site and used his personal email account and got an email on his work account that was a sale attached to what he had done. And he said, that is wrong. If I'm giving information about me in a personal capacity, why should they be able to connect those dots and get to me at my place of work? We are very often faced with this question of how should we use this data? What should we want to accept? What should we expect from corporations? I had a discussion with a chief data officer, and they said they put together a framework to help them understand what their stance was on the privacy of their customer data. This was at a bank. And she said she thought it would maybe be a 2 to 3 months exercise. They'd been at it 9 months and were finally getting close, but really weren't finished, because that's how long it took for them to wrestle through the implications of the decisions that they were making and the different pressures on, if I have this data, I can make this decision. But if you have that data and you make that decision, that might not be fair. And this is something I heard in a talk from Kathy O'Neill, who's the author of the book Weapons of Math Destruction, MATH. And what she said fundamentally was, at some point, organizations will have to decide between profit and fairness. And no organization wants to hear that. They want to think that they're doing good in the world. But in many cases, what is best for the bottom line actually is not what you want from a perspective of fairness. And somehow I got two extra slides in here, so we'll just skip that. So how do we build responsible tech? How do we get out of our own head? And what does responsible tech really mean? When I talk about responsible tech, it encompasses a wide range of ethics, sustainability, all of those different things. What we want to do is we want to align the behaviors of organizations and our technology with the interests of individuals and society. How can we do that? How can we get out of our own head? We've put together a responsible tech playbook that includes all kinds of facilitation techniques, almost all of them created by others. There's something called the tarot cards of tech, and you basically deal out these cards that will try to get you to think in a different way about your technology. Because what you want to do is you want prompts that help you think, gee, what if I was a woman of color living in rural India? How would I respond to this? We have to get out of our own heads. We can do what we can to build a diverse team, but let's face it, at the moment, anybody who's going to be building technology with us, chances are, has had a pretty privileged existence to have that level of education. So how do we start to think about what impact our technology will have on people who do not look like us? But I don't want to just focus on the bad, because one of the things you can also get when you start to get out of your own head and explore the space around is, what are the opportunities that you haven't looked at? Maybe you are so focused on this target audience, and with just a little tweak to what it is you're trying to do, you can have a much larger audience. Wouldn't that be wonderful? So the purpose is to build teams and use processes that will allow you to think outside your head, and that will allow you to become a tech pragmatist, because we cannot deny the power that technology has for solving many of the problems that we have in the world. But we also should not deny that some of that has downsides that we need to mitigate. And that's where this positioning as a pragmatist comes in. Thank you very much for your attention.